Some of you were here 2 years ago when I spoke about this. You will actually, it will be a rehearsal. You will see if you remember everything correctly. So, but then there is a few new faces, so some of it might be new to you. So, bear with me. But a second look will look like this. That was the presentation 2 years ago. This is a second. And when I gave that presentation, I finished with an image which I saw 3 years ago when you were in Innsbruck and went up to Hub. I can tell you at least among Swedish historians of science is almost unknown. And it's the man to the left of that image. His name is Axel Kurlin. And he met apparently with Hess in June in 1930. So what was happening there? So that was the mystery I left off with. So we try to investigate that a bit. And since quite a few of you are specialized also in the history of cosmic rays, you might have then encountered Axel Kurlin. And he was a lecturer in his professional life at the gymnasium, but also actually the discovery of the supernova. You don't do that every day. In 1918.
It's only a nova.
And
1918, no distinction.
No. But he was also a popular science writer. He wrote a book in Swedish. If you translate it, revolt against conformity, worldview in historical and modern physical light. He eventually made a PhD in astronomy with astronomic nucleon, like in Lund University in southern Sweden, with the type of cosmic ultra radiation in northern Sweden. And previously, around the time he met with Hess, he published a paper. Again, this is the ultrastrahlungsmessungen in Nordschweden, in 1930. It's not the lecturer there, but it's an interesting story. If you look into the history of popular astronomy in Sweden, he is an important figure. He was a student. He was originally from Gothenburg, but he went to Uppsala University to study astronomy. But for the summer break, he was visiting his parents. And from the balloon, balcony, something different sorry. On his parents' flat in central Gothenburg, he actually made this discovery. He called his colleagues in Uppsala, and they hadn't seen anything of this at the observatory there. So. That was definitely his claim to fame, and at least in Sweden he was very much in all newspapers and so on, that this young student, it was a sort of fascinating story. And eventually, in the end, this led to a very popular rise in the interest in astronomy in Gothenburg. So a few years later they established a rather well-equipped amateur observatory in Gothenburg. And if you go up to northern Sweden, you might see this. And if you don't recognize the scenery, what's on the ground is one of the world's largest pieces of iron rock. It's the Kirunavaara mine. Looks like that, not today perhaps, but at least most of the year in winter time. And so what he did, he made had the idea that he should use the facilities of the mine to go down to have an equivalent of the water depth measurements to the equivalent of 500 meters. So that was something that he did. But that was also made, you probably know, by Nishina and Ishii in at an even higher or deeper measurements at, I think, 700 meters and so on. Clay, I don't know if it went into any mines, but at least used went deep. So anyway, that was what I could figure out that he made, but we should return to Corleen later on. This, unfortunately, it's a very good image, but it's hard to read, I'm afraid. So you have to trust me. So now we will return. Now it will be the rehearsal of two years back, and tell you the story how the Nobel system works, and we will go into now look into some of the documents that was interesting to see in, and tell you the story how Hess finally got the Nobel Prize in 1936. And this machinery, it works all year round, and that is what you should understand from this. It's not the, if you can read at least the different months. So you actually start more than a year ahead the work to prepare and to send out invitations to nominate. So already now, this starting point, that in October the nomination, the invitations to nominate is sent out. And the nominations should be given until the in the beginning of the year, and then the process of fishing up the most important candidates for that year, and that is a very important, which is often difficult to understand. You can never have a Nobel Prize if you haven't been nominated. You could have 100 nominations the year before, but you need at least one. It's not who gets the most nomination that will get the prize. It's not, as I said last time, and we repeat again, it's not the Eurovision Song Contest. It's some more qualities involved. But of course, a large number of nominations, of course, build up a strong case in there. But anyway, this of course is an operation that works. Oh, thank you. And of course the committee, and we'll go into that, makes a report on that. This has changed during the year. Actually, the very first years of the Nobel, up until the prize awarding ceremony, they were not known to the public or the media, so they were sort of just presented on stage while they received the prize. But later on that changed, and now it's in October that the presentation of the nomination is made, or of the prize award is made. And then in December is on the death day of Alfred Nobel is the awarding ceremony in Stockholm and in Oslo. This you can read, I think. Okay, legitimate nominations by the end of January. It's still, I was then, a five-person committee, and they did quite a substantial part of the work, select a number of main candidates and do special reports. Up until around 1960, the five persons in the committee made all the special reports. Nowadays, there might be people in here, you don't have to agree, but sometimes during the 1960s, I think, they changed the rules so actually people outside of the committee could also do special reports, but then they have to sign that they are not allowed to talk about it. But of course then up until 1960 we can all agree that then of course these five persons are important to understand who they are. Of course all Swedish physicists are very brilliant and understand everything every year to the best, but of course often there is a discussion, of course, was is the Nobel Prize a blessing or a curse for Swedish physics? If it's a blessing, people say, you get all the information. You should be the best in the world because you know everything that is happening. Could be, but you could also say that you take this five person, the best physicist, and they are occupied half a year in writing reports and evaluations and so on. So it's a mixed blessings, as most things in life, I suppose. But then the committee doesn't decide. The committee presents its work to the physics class of the academy. So then there are more physicists, and not always all physicists agree. we had an exercise earlier on. But then the committee also writes a general report, a short report, to be 10, 15, 20 pages, which they present to the whole of the academy. So then the whole of the academy, mathematicians, astronomers, chemists, everyone's vote is as good as the physicist's vote. Even historians' votes count. So the academy in pleno votes for the prize in the end. Now you've heard this, a few of you have heard this two times now, so now you know how it works. You know perhaps also that there were a few earlier nominations than in 1936. The first, I think, is Poellau in 1931. This is not the nomination, and you can't read, and if you can read, you have to know Swedish, because that is also part of the problem in studying this material. But here they talk about Hess work, but what they say, see if I can see. One main argument is that as this Hess hypothesis, you see where we are going, it's a hypothesis, dates back so far in time as 1912. There is no reason or possibility to award him a Nobel Prize for the discovery. And then you realize that, of course, he gets the prize 5 years later, so that's even more back in time. So you understand what kind of course this is. This is the kind of arguing that goes into this. There were a few other nominations, but of course in 1936 it's the interesting year. And of course it's not just Hess that was the candidate that year. It could be interesting, you could perhaps see and recognize a few names here. Sommerfeld, famous for never being awarded the Nobel Prize, perhaps. But you see Anderson got quite a few. And there are a few names that you might recognize and a few perhaps that you don't. There were 22 different nominations that year, the candidates. But then of course, some of the candidates the committee just dismissed. They have been looked into earlier, nothing new. But this year they look into Bjerknes. You might be surprised, he was a meteorologist, a Norwegian. Did very important work there, but actually it's sort of this is a principal decision, they say. Metrology is not possible to have a Nobel Prize for. So that was dismissed this year and forever, you could say. Fermi was also main candidate that has spent some time in the special report, I think the general report, but he was more on hold. He said, can't have the Nobel Prize this year. Davison and Garmer was also important because also a group of the physicists, not in the committee but in the class of the academy, had proposed them, so that we will return to that. But the committee said their work was not, there were other people involved, so they were not uniquely original in their in work. And this is one of the nominations by Clay, and he knew what he was talking about. A nomination that could just be, I nominate person X. End of story. Sometimes it's rather lengthy, substantial. So this is, I would say, an average nomination letter. Also, the text was, it looked better on my own computer. And you can't probably read this either, but it's what I claim to be the essential nomination by Compton. And this is, as you see, it's a rather like even more longer letter where he goes through this what has happened, and he also sort of addresses this problem that Hess discovery was way back in time, and say that it's recent, and that is often the case. You know that quite a lot of Nobel Prize laureates wasn't awarded the same year. You know, in the Nobel's will, it says that the award should go to someone who had made a discovery in the preceding year. And then a lot of mistakes have been made. But what the sort of general worked out solution is that you, of course, during the last year, we have realized that it was an important discovery way back in time. And this quantum have understood, so he goes through and make an argument and also proposes a connection with Anderson. And also Clay is part of Compton's proposal. So Hess got two nominations, one from Clay in 1936, so he has enough nominations like that. But also, most importantly, if you read how the committee argues, they were most sort of listening, I would say, to Compton's arguments. So a third of the prize was the nomination from Compton for Victor Hess. Oh, you see the 36, perhaps you could see, you probably see that it says 36 down there. This was the committee, five persons. Henry Clay was the chairman. At least you might recognize Manne Siegbahn, Nobel Prize winner. Poellau is my favorite, the only theoretical physicist in the committee. But Echophysics is the interesting person because he writes up the special report. He was a molecular spectroscopist, a professor of physics at Stockholm College then, what is now Stockholm University, and for a long period a member of the Nobel Committee. He wrote a special report in 1936 for the committee and for the physics class. But he also made actually an extra report, which is not common, general accessible, it actually said, to be presented to the academy when the whole of the academy should be discussed. So that was, I don't know actually the reason why, but he was interested to do that. And he goes quite along the lines of Compton's argument. And of course, in these reports, they just don't talk about the persons. It's actually a very good overview, and quite a lot of all the other names that we know are involved in the story is mentioned in this report. Pacini, for example, that had died, that of course then could be awarded the prize, is mentioned in this report. Pacini was never nominated, so you see the kind of problems that's in this. So that's why I would say that these general reports and special reports are actually a very nice annual snapshot of the state of physics and chemistry. But see, they are in Swedish, so you know you have to go to the language course. You have to trust me. Lennart Singer, he was a theoretical physicist. He is famous for his work on hydrodynamics, but also on liquid crystals. He was a very good friend of Niels Bohr. He's the man behind the Nobel Prize to the solution how you should award the Nobel to Einstein, because the Academy was too anxious to give Einstein the Nobel Prize for the theories of relativity. But Poellau is the only one that ever nominates Einstein only and exclusively for the photoelectric effect, which the Academy could, you know. Einstein could have had three Nobel Prizes or more. The strange thing in that context is that Einstein wasn't nominated after he got the Nobel Prize. We know, I mean, Curie had gotten two Nobel Prizes, so it's a strange... So anyone who knows how to explain that to me, please do. It's perhaps too much word to say it's an ideology. Poellau was very anxious that theoretical physics especially could just... So he was sort of a bit reluctant with the new atomic physics, that he was more happy with Niels Bohr's first work and so on. But after a while, and he was the only one on the committee that actually could understand this, I would say. But in bold face here, he also goes on the line on the Compton. And so we can see that Compton together, sorry, Anderson together with Hess makes a very good Nobel Prize couple back here. But I said, and I said this last time in this presentation, Gustav Ising, there were several other members of the physics class that had the idea that there should be a Nobel Prize to Davison and Germer instead. And that's the paper to the Nobel Committee. You can't read that, but you see the original document, in which it says, in Swedish, the proposed combination Hess-Anderson, through which Hess' fundamental discovery of the cosmic radiation, all the Davison's and Grandin's experiment, now should be awarded together with Anderson's there to genetically attached discovery of the positron as particularly motivated and appealing. So they step back and say, okay, and this could of course be it. Tactics, so then they could have their candidate the next year. But of course, the coupling is the essential thing. So, we end up with the Physics Nobel Prize 1936. Hess for his discovery of cosmic radiation, which is the quotation that goes on the diploma, and Anderson for his discovery of the positron. And instead of going to Poellau in summer, you get to go to Stockholm in December. Cold, dark, but you get to dress up. That's all. So we know that. Okay, I will now finish. Corinne's work, as I started with which intrigued me a bit, and all others, I would say, contributors into this field was mentioned in an overview paper by Anna Beckman, the editor of the Swedish physicist yearbook Cosmos in 1936, when she also made a presentation of the Nobel Prize, where she mentions, for example, Corinne's work as well, but also several others. But already in 1930, another overview paper by another person had been written in this journal. So there was actually some sense of that things were happening in this field in Sweden, even though there were not that many people doing cosmic ray research in Sweden, except for Karl. And what happens is that Karl, as I said, I also already in the first image that he didn't make a career out of cosmic rays. He made a career that he went to the gymnasium as a lecturer. It was problematic because cosmic rays was then seen that it was in between physics and astronomy. He was also his professor, Knut Lundmark, well known in Sweden because he was a great popularizer. But he was too much to popular science, so the other astronomers and so on were a bit suspicious of him. So being a pupil of him was not was the first mistake in looking for an academic career at least. It changes later on, actually, after World War II, I would say, in Sweden. I don't think Per Karlsson is here in the room. He was at the Innsbruck meeting, I think, in Swedish. You could have told me more about that. And I already said, the conclusion is it's not the Eurovision style competition, only once a year occurs. That's a similarity, but it's not the same thing. The important thing was that Anderson and Hess made a good solution. That is at least what you could do also for other Nobel Prizes, to see that they work together in that way. Well, since I built the Arena experiment, should be lead each other. Of course, this was not as important in this case. But essentially, the genetic pair of Anderson and Hess is the message, and the other conclusions is what I want to bring to you once again. Thank you.